nature to know that I'm here for you forever true. He's misunderstood. Some say that he's up to no good around the neighborhood.
Welcome, guys, to this episode of the Weekly Link Up. I'm here with the incredibly talented Mr. Ant. How's it going, Ant?
All's well, man. How you doing?
Right. Pretty good. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us. So let's start off with your name. Your name is actually an acronym. The name Ant is an acronym. Tell us about that and how that came about.
Well, actually, the first person to ever call me Ant was my Uncle Joey. It's when I was younger. And ever since I picked up a pen, I knew there was a different purpose for my life. Not just right for my own well-being, but the right for other people's enlightenment. And that's where the name comes from, you know, because we desire, we yearn for things, but, you know, there's no better yearning in this life to, other than enlightening people, you know, making them better than they already are. So, the name is All Have Yearnings, None Truer Than Enlightenment, which is literally how I live my life. It is the course I take. It is how I direct everything that I do, is to enlighten others and to uplift them.
Awesome. So did you know as a kid that you wanted to be a poet, you wanted to go into philanthropy, this would be your life? Was this already your vision?
This was purpose to me. It was my calling before I knew it. When I first started, actually, I always wanted to be an engineer. I always wanted to be an engineer.
Kind of polar opposite.
Yeah, it's like, and I got my degree in engineering and you know, it's weird that you can get a degree in something, but sometimes in life, when you have a calling, you have to do what it's calling you. What's funny is, if you get to ask me when I was younger, I wanted to work for Johnson & Johnson. I wanted to be a chemical engineer and work for Johnson & Johnson. And that was like my dream job. But God has something for you. no matter how you run from it, no matter what course you think you're going to take, He always pulls you back in.
Right. Okay, wow, that's pretty interesting. So, I mean, that's inspiration for people that think that they may be doing something this way, but they have another talent. So, when did you write your first poem?
Ever since I could pick up a pencil. Ever since I could write my name, I've been writing poetry.
Okay.
The grammar was horrible, as well as the spelling. But poetry, songs, I've been writing since I could write. My grandmother still has stories, pictures I've drawn, everything. She makes fun of me all the time.
Still got that story you wrote.
it's just been a call of it. Well, yeah, I've been in August, and I've been writing since I knew what letters meant.
Okay. Fuse poetry and art with philanthropy, because you do a lot of things in the community. You mentor, you have a mentoring program. How does that, what pushes you to fuse the two together?
Well, I always wanted to kind of give back.
Okay.
And the reality is when, you know, I went through this journey in my life, like in the last 7 years. I used to make a lot of money, I used to be in the military. And after that, I got out as a manager with a large retail company. And I've always made a good, significant amount of money. But when I did those things, like in making money, I didn't give back as much as I should have. Okay. So God took me through this course. He kind of took some things away from me. He made me reevaluate my existence. And he showed me that I have a skill. I have a talent. Use that talent to change lives. Don't fall into the ways of this world. Literally, use your poetry to make people's lives better, to open their eyes, to share, and get into philanthropy. There's a poem, it's called The Calling, that I wrote. And in it, I say that you can make change even with change. That is a lesson that I've learned in my life, that because I stand in front of people, because I'm always in the presence of people, I have the ability to influence them, you know, for better. And that's where it came from. That's where it all stems from.
So it's definitely, it's a personal calling that that's what you should be.
Without doubt.
Yeah. Without doubt. That's amazing. So what does Ant, when your life is, when you're 75, 80, and you know, you've done all that you would do, you're just kind of like coasting and just resting, what do you want your legacy to look like?
Honestly, that is the purpose that I do all of this.
Okay.
You know, if I go back and I really get to the heart of why I am the way I am, I think of my kids, and I think of my relationship with my parents and how I view, you know, my father and my mother and their successes and failures in life. I want to leave a legacy behind that my kids can look at and say, you know what, my father made a difference. He did everything he possibly could do to change this world. I don't ever want to feel like my kids are ashamed of me, you know. And that's really genuinely why I push. Sometimes I'm unrelenting, and some people say, hey, you need to sit still, chill out. I was like, well, the reality is this world's not gonna stop, so why should I stop?
Right.
But you know, I want my kids to genuinely look at my life and say that my father did a lot, you know, that he made changes, that he cared about his community. You know, it's so much more than you know, standing in front of people and accolades. No, I want all my kids, you know, to look at me and be like, hey, my dad, you know, was the next Martin Luther King. Something like that.
Right,
you know,
right.
Something, whatever comparison they want to make.
That, wow, that was so bland. Let's do it again. Give me some energy or I will come to your table, all right? My words are my power.
So let them create.
And love, and love. I got another piece that I don't ever really read or it's called Ourselves. I wrote this poem, man, because I take a look at the way things are in our society, man, and it bothers me. Like, it genuinely hurts, man, to watch how we suffer and create our own kind of self-mutilation, man. So this poem is called Ourselves because we have to take a good look at ourselves to try to figure out what's wrong with this, you know, what things are. Inshallah, I will find you. I will find you. She didn't even hear her name. That's how much she's not paying attention. It's all right, though. So we're about to kick these things off. There are too many blocks, too many hoods, way too many families and children struggling for our woulda, shoulda, coulds. They're teaching our future a broken view of what's truly good. See, the problem lies in our brainwashed mentality. We as a people have been fashioned to accept a destructive reality, so focused on right now that our future will become a casualty. Our whole perception is broken. We're closing all the doors that truly need to be open. See, because where do you find the hope when we've been made to believe that success is found through physical appearance or material? And you can only find respect if your actions are criminal. Those catchy tunes our children sing word for word but can't spell their own names are nothing more than subliminal messages of destruction.
I think it's amazing, too, that, you know, you have this talent and that you are open to your children, you know, going into the arts as well. I talk a lot of times, and you know, we hear a lot of times, just kind of in our community, we're kind of told we have to make money, we have to make money. And so, you know, our purpose to go to college, and I know for myself, it's kind of the same thing. I needed to make money. That was numero uno. Like, when I graduate, I need to be able to make this certain salary. And, you know, for you to be able to provide it for your children to say, hey, you know, the arts is what you want, that's what you should get. I think that's amazing.
That's actually one of the lessons I teach to kids when I go to schools and I talk to them. I speak to them about the reality that in this life, you will never be happy chasing behind someone else's happiness. And that's what happens in big business.
Wow.
You're chasing behind somebody else's happiness. You're not going to find happiness there. You find what you love, stick to that.
Wow.
Perfect it. When you perfect it, you'll start making new money. That's backward poetry. I loved it.
Yeah.
I loved it. And I stuck to it. And, you know, when you love something, you'll learn everything about it.
Right.
You know, like if you like math, you will learn everything about math.
Right.
And
right.
You become good at it, and it'll get to a point to where it'll start being making a livelihood for you. And that's what poetry made. I loved it so much. I perfected it, and it started making money for me. And I teach kids that all the time.
Yeah.
You know, that it's not about making all the money in the world. You know,
right.
I know sometimes songs tell us, oh yeah, make six figures this, six figures that, bling, bling, look at this car. But they're doing those things to mask unhappiness. So we got to teach kids what joy is like.
Right.
You know, what happiness really means.
Right.
Teach kids and teach adults, man.
Yeah.
A lot of adults that need to learn that. So let's talk about verbal lessons. Tell us a little bit about the history of it, when it got started, how did you get it started, and what things you guys have coming up with verbal lessons.
blessing, a God's gift from above. I remember when we brought you from the hospital, I was overwhelmed with love. Your tiny little hands, feet, and nose, chubby little cheeks, and itty-bitty toes. Your name was Jasmine for the year that you was born. The day she was born was the day I was reborn.
Verbal lessons, actually four verbal lessons here at the Widow's Cafe. It was expressive love.
Okay.
It was hosted by a good friend of mine, Reform Butterfly, and now husband, DJ Monster.
Okay.
And they had to step away. They had some family things they needed to take care of. You know, sometimes you have to revision yourself and take care of family.
Right.
And I kind of picked up the reins. And 2 years before I even started the show, I had a vision of what I wanted it to be. It wasn't, you know, the same format as Expressive Thought Mondays. It was completely different. So I came, I spoke to the managers of the Widow's Cafe. I let them know my vision, what my goals were, and they were like, you know what? Go for it. And it's been beautiful, man. It's been beautiful, man. You know, poetry, singing, live painting, you know, a family environment. It is, you know, I used to be a single father for years. And one of the main reasons why I make this a family environment is because I used to hate having to go to poetry places. I can't bring my kid. You know,
right.
You know, I can't bring Sam. I mean, or AJ, you know what I mean? It's like, okay, what do I do?
Right.
You know, so I created an environment to where it's nurturing to not only, you know, the creative mind, but also to children.
Right.
You know, that's what it's about.
Amazing. So what types of things are coming up with verbal lessons? I hear you guys have a big special monthly thing that everybody can get involved with.
Right. Tell us about that. Okay. Once a month, we do a different charity of verbal lessons. This month, coming up, December holidays, you know, you gotta love it. We're doing Toys for Tot Drive.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And it's December 9th. Y'all, actually, we're gonna start a little early. Normally, we start at 7 p.m., but because last year's show was so huge, we're gonna start at 6 p.m. and work our way into it, you know. So it's gonna be amazing, man. 1602 Walnut, right downtown in the historic part of Springfield, on the corners of 6th and Walnut, man. This is the place to be. And get here early, you know, seats.
Trust me, I know for sure. Well, I definitely appreciate it, man. Let us know how we can get involved. We can follow you on social media, how we can get more of your poetry, hear about things that you have coming up with. What can we
All right. You can find me at ahynte.com. That's ahynte.com.
Okay.
You can also find me on Facebook at facebook.com/ahynte. Check us out on, you know, the Verbal Essence page. That's facebook.com/verbalessenceshow. Just like Verbal Essence, it's with a V. Verbal Essence Show. And it's here at Three Bears Cafe, man. I'm always on social media. I don't tweet very much because I have a life. And I don't do Instagram because I'm not that name. You know how people do, man.
Stab to the people that have Twitter and Instagram.
Yeah, man. So, you know, I'm not on Instagram, but you can find me on Facebook and Twitter. I tweet motivational things. You can also find me in the morning. I do a spiritual breakfast. That's what I call it. It's a morning devotional.
Okay.
Yeah, man. And check me out on Facebook for the details of that, man. It's every morning at 8 a.m. I do a devotional. I do a morning prayer devotional and a spiritual challenge every morning for the people that join in, man.
Wow.
That's really dope, man. So find me on Facebook.
Gotcha. Check them out. Thank you so much. I appreciate you. We at Form Garden League Up, we thank you, man. Your inspiration. If there's anything else that we can do with you, collaborate, promote some things you have coming on in the new year, let us know. All right.
Hey, New Year's will be big. Boom.
All right. 2014.
Gotcha.